Hey, it's nice to see you. I was reading the Rust Nomicon for fun. Well, actually, I wanted to double check some knowledge that I had kind of picked up around the send and sync traits, and I came across this really neat example of some, I suppose, really deep Rust code, but also very informative Rust code that I think would be quite handy to implement to teach you a little bit about some internals about what the box type does. And I thought, you know what, let's record a video on how to implement box. Okay, cool. So I'll leave that over on the right here and I'll bring out a code editor and let's go and get going. So I'll create a new project. And they talk about cartons here and boxes. I really prefer a different analogy, which is that of a portal into some other location in the address space. The portal feels like I've got like a gate in local scope. If I go through the portal or I pull the thing out of the portal, I get access to the stuff that I had stored on the other side of the portal. And I feel like that's a slightly better analogy. The terminology has definitely stuck though, so it's not as though I can go and change history. But yeah, so we're building a portal, and I start with just the boilerplate code that Cargo created for us, and let's go and get building. Okay, so I've got my portal of type T, and inside, right now I just want to start very, very basic. A tuple struct, we've just basically taking T, and then we've got some function, oh sorry, implement a function over my type T. And we're going to be addressing two things, which is one, what a type variable is, and two, what happens when you pass an object or some data value to a function by value instead of by reference. I'm going to create a constructor. You can see here that's the same function arguments as what is provided on the right, whereby we have some value of any type T, and we return self, which refers back to the type that is being implemented for this portal T. And I do that by essentially like wrapping the value of variable inside self, and capital S self refers to some it refers to me, the at least but where we haven't initialized anything yet, so it's a type variable as well. If I wanted to, I could have done things in full, which is I think this portal T value. Now, I'm actually going to get a compiler warning straight away. And that is a warning about the fact that T doesn't exist. Now, if isn't found in scope, and you're looking at this code thinking Rust, you're wrong here, mate. Look, struct T, I've got T's all over the place. There are more T's in this piece of code than any other letter. What are you talking about? Well, one of the things that it's talking about is that implementation blocks are independent. So I could have some type, let's say this one's type variable B. I can call this B anywhere I want. And so I need to actually provide local scope, at least within the scope of this implementation block or this impl block. T refers to the specific thing is sort of context dependent, whereas over here, and let's say I create new two, and we may as well use this. So let's say I've got my portal is of type portal, and I'm creating new two, and let's say that I've got 1, 2, 3. And I'm going to need to give that a specific type, most likely. So I'll give it a 1, 2, 3 as an integer. And that's going to probably work. I get a build, my code is built, and then I get a whole bunch of things around, unused. So I'll just do something, a derive debug, just so we've got something to do with our code. Eventually, we will actually re-implement box, by the way. I just want to set some foundations here so that we don't lose our friendly, we don't lose people, because there are some people that don't have a lot of knowledge about Rust, and Rust is a confusing, complex programming language. So, oops, that wasn't what I wanted to do. I wanted to run, and I'll add the dash Q flag, not the dash P flag. And then I get portal 123. Okay, so we've successfully put our 123 and given it to our portal. Now, if we were to take our portal analogy, I basically sent it to the gate, but I haven't actually gone through the portal yet. Like, the portal doesn't do anything. It doesn't do anything with the data. And that's what the rest of the code over on the right does. It essentially opens up the portal, initializes some data, some memory in some other place, writes the value to that location. I guess if the value, we'll start that again. We open up some area of the redress space initial, and then send our value to it, and then write to that. So, but I did explain what a type variable was. We don't actually need new to at all, so I'll take that away. The other thing that I wanted to describe was the distinction between a reference and an owned type. In this case, we are specifying that the ownership of T belongs to the portal. It's now impossible for the caller. Let's say that value in, and I pass it into my portal. It's now actually, should be impossible for me to access in, even within local scope. Oh, and he's, and the reason why this doesn't work in this case is because in is a not is a primitive type which implements copy. So I'm just going to do something that isn't. So I'm just gonna, oops. Let's just call this oof. Now my oof, you know, it just embarrassed me in front of, you know, at least no one's actually watching the thing. Doesn't implement debug. That's a different error than what I expected. Gosh, this is annoying. Yeah. You know, you... Aha! This is the actual error that I was hoping for. Borrow of moved value in. So what you can see here is that even though we have got in on line 15, and it remains in local scope later on line 18. And moreover, we don't delete it, we don't mutate it or anything, Rust ownership system will prohibit in from being accessed from the calling scope. Ownership has passed into the portal. So portal can now do whatever it wants with the data. Okay, cool. What does the portal want to do? Well, we talked about the fact that a portal is like it represents like a location in memory that is outside or somewhere else on the address space. So I'm going to bring in, and the data type that enables these sorts of manipulations are called pointers. A pointer may sound like a scary thing. However, it isn't as scary, hopefully, as what you might expect. In Rust, we avoid let's describe what a pointer is. A pointer is just a number that happens to also provide information to the compiler about the data type that is connected to the other side, like at the address. Memory is represented sort of as a like a linear from zero all the way down or all the way up. So start at zero and we'll go all the way up to 2^64 - 1. So we'll sort of remove that zero element. But in our case, we want to guarantee to the type system that our pointer will never be null. This is one of the guarantees that Rust provides you, that the types that you're interacting with within Safe Rust could never be what is known as the null pointer. Except we're sort of going to do something which looks immediately like we're going to cheat on that. We're going to create a null pointer. Null pointers are safe to create. They're just not safe to what we call dereference. I'm going to change this back to self. And inside, and my value is now going to be a pointer. So I would like to just say mem pointer. This isn't quite enough. This syntax here, star mute space t, is actually a specific type. Every pointer type encodes the information about what it is pointing to. And so therefore we also have this type variable on the right hand side. And we need to convert this to a non-null pointer. Use our pet keyword, our let keyword, pointer, and the call that we'll take is like pointer non-null, and then we'll pass in our mem pointer. So this sounds kind of silly. Why would we bother? And we're doing this because it is the why are we doing that here? Why would we want to worry about non-null pointers? It's because we want to avoid what is known as the quote-unquote billion-dollar mistake. For various reasons, which are actually documented here on the right, we will never have a case where non-null will return none. We could do this, else return something like that, to be more explicit. However, if we've reached line 14 here, like life has gone very, very badly for us. And allow me first to explain. We will never get there. What we now need to do, we have a pointer to some address in memory. What we now want to do is what we call allocate some space for our value of some type T. Now, to do that, we kind of invoke the unsafe keyword, which is a description to the compiler that what we are doing, we guarantee to be safe. The compiler no longer has access to, won't have access to what we are doing, which is essentially calling into the operating system. To do that, I'm going to take a dependency on libc, and I'm going to take a dependency on version 0.2. And libc is my interaction to the Linux or to the Unix or a POSIX memory interface. Essentially, it's a direct line to the operating system internals. This isn't strictly necessary. We could actually implement everything ourselves directly, but I don't want to. So Now, I'm going to introduce some horrific syntax. I'm going to try and call this function POSIX mem align. And to do that, the first argument is a pointer to some value. And then I need to sort of cast it back. So I take my mem pointer, which is, and I convert it back to a reference. So I take a mutable reference to my mutable pointer, and then I cast that as a mutable pointer to a mutable pointer. So this is, we can do it inside the block, is the address that we are going to give to our allocation function. And then we are going to say that we're going to sort of specify how we want to align our variables in memory. So this is a bit weird. What do I mean by alignment? The other thing that I need to pull into local scope is this comparison function. So I can compare these two values, and if I'm aligned of and I align of and size of, oops, yeah. Keep pushing page down, use standard mem align of and size of is off. The syntax is looking a bit weird there. I wonder, oh, probably because of this. And okay, so I've got an address and I've got an alignment. We need to describe what an alignment is. It turns out that CPUs really like to be able to have valid bytes at offsets that are like at memory addresses that are divisible by, in our case, by 64 bytes. If you're using a 64-bit CPU. So what this says is that you should give me the closest, and in fact, this is going to sound a bit weird, give me the closest power of 2 bytes that is also divisible by 8 from T. So if you've got some large struct, it will take the next power of 2 up. And if you have a very small type, let's say an integer, like we're passing in down here below, then you can just get away with, or you ask for extra data. So we are trading off a space, that is, we're asking for more space than strictly necessary, because we get significantly faster performance if we do not use aligned values, or so-called aligned values, for our data. The CPU hardware actually needs to do a lot more work. And lastly, we need to describe how much to allocate. I think I may have got that explanation a bit wrong. I think that that alignment and how much to allocate, which is the number of the bytes that sizeof has, work together. Now, this is some error code. Now, if the error code is 0, then things succeeded. So if error code isn't 0, then we panic at the moment, but I think we should do better. It turns out there are 2 types of there are two errors that you can have. You can either fail on your alignment parameter. You know, you could actually specify something that is illegal. Or you could fail because when you attempted to allocate memory, that is reserve memory from the operating system, that call can itself fail. So what I want to do, and error code is just an integer. It's, but if you call, crates.io, crates, libc, I can actually go and get a slightly better error message out of this. And allow me to show you how to do so. We want error for inval, I think. Oh, maybe I need to go and look it up. So the way to look it up is call, we could search for the function here in libc. We don't get much at all. We just get the types. So that's not extremely useful. So another option is to actually just do a search on your search engine and look through some of this documentation. It's a little bit more complicated to read C type definitions than it is to read Rust code. At least that's my view. But you can see here, do you remember how we said that the first argument is a pointer to a pointer? We've got alignment and size. And it returns either error inval, so that is an invalid. So an error for invalid, so that's alignment was not some power of two, or a multiple of size of void star, so the void pointer, which is, someone will know. There'll be a comment. What is the multiple of size of void? I'm not sure what a void star, it's probably 64 bytes in the on a 64-bit computer. And error, no memory. So there's not enough memory to actually specify or satisfy this. So if I hunt for error inval, so we could actually say we can match on error code and say libc error invalid, and then just what could we do here? We could panic and say alignment incorrect. Alternatively, we could encounter error no mem. And if we were, and it's, yeah, it's just a constant, it's just an integer 12. At least it's an integer 12 on Linux currently. So I don't believe, and on like the specific version of, strictly you should just use your libc version for the actual C compiler and the OS and combinations, because every implementation of C essentially gets to set these macros themselves. So don't hard code, for instance, 12 in there, even though it's defined inside the crate. Because then you don't have portable code. Now, if you don't have enough memory to allocate, then life is really going to be bad for you. So otherwise, we actually succeed. So your panic, your program is sort of toast at this point. Now, if we reach to zero, it means that we have modified memory pointer with POSIX memoline, and everything has succeeded. So you can see here in the original code, they don't go and touch anything else. Essentially, we're done. Except for, well, that was a poor choice of words. We're done with the allocation portion. Now we are in a position where we can guarantee. So now we're in a position that the pointer at memory pointer is no longer null. Essentially, we have guaranteed that that this will always succeed. One way that we could, I mean, one way around this would be, we could return, we could update memory pointer from this unsafe block if we wanted to, but let's not worry. And the other thing in terms of good practice that we could do is avoid anything that doesn't need unsafe. Presumably also, for example, we could return, so the only thing that we're saying is unsafe is the actual call to the libc POSIX memo line, and that makes it really clear what our intent is to use a C API. But I will allow you as a programmer who has integrity to use the unsafe keyword diligently. And also there is some stylistic stuff as well. So now the last part of our puzzle is to actually write our value to the memory address that we have just allocated for. So we take, so we've got self pointer, and we do this actually inside over here. So so we know, by the way, that POSIX does the right thing. Also, this POSIX underscore memoline function will provide us some non-null space. It gives us a pointer that is valid for writes and properly aligned. So that is going to work. And we can return that as is. Arguably, actually, what they've done with the expect here, or even an unwrap, would be slightly easier to read. So an alternative to using an if let and this unreachable block is to just unwrap and then write and then return the pointer. By the way, we are introducing a race condition. We are guaranteeing, if the code, if in here, at this point where I've got my exclamation marks on line 31, if somehow the thread that was calling this was suspended and some other thread thought that it should just access the memory, it would, or access this pointer, which it doesn't have access to, so it shouldn't really matter, then there would be a problem, because we haven't actually guaranteed at this point here's even worse. At this point here, we don't have our, we haven't actually upheld our guarantee. At that point, we haven't written any data to it. So it's actually a non-null pointer that happens to be null. Whoops. Actually, that's not fair. It's just a pointer. It itself is pointing to null, to memory that is null. So, gosh. Now, we actually have a program again that should compile. It doesn't unclose delimiter, some syntax errors, so I can fix those. 45. Oh, gosh. This is why I should actually use the some error, like a proper editor instead of just doing things all manually myself. This isn't actually what it was complaining about. Expected, I found I9-32. This expression has type unit. Oh. Help, use the literal syntax itself. Ah, so non-null. Ah, interestingly. So what I should have done was call new here. However, one of the things that I could have done was to do what it recommends, which is to use the literal syntax and say, here's my pointer. And then I don't need the call to unwrap. I'm not sure if that... And now I get this thing about initially into it runs unsafe and requires an unsafe valid. Aha, so that's why you use the new method. Because strictly this is safe. And now I get this unused warning about 1, 2, 3. And because I removed the oof struct from before, I can now break the ownership rules. Okay. So I can't access anything on the other side of the portal now. I need to be able to kind of pull things back. And the way that Rust enables this is by implementing the deref and deref mute or mut traits. And now, so let's actually do this a little bit differently. Let's bring it back. You know, it embarrassed me once, embarrassed me twice or something. We've got some oof, and I'm going to wrap my 1, 2, 3, and it doesn't matter which type of integer it is, it will all work. And now I can, so now I can take portal, and if I dereference it, I can pluck out the value again. Ah, I do need to put T into scope. And cardin is not found. Oh, okay, so this is not implemented for a cardin. It's implemented for the portal type. Cannot be implemented for measure. Ah, okay. So I get an oof, and now I need to implement dereg. Oof, 1, 2, 3, hooray. So we have been able to send our oof through the portal into some other space on the, some other location in memory, and then pluck it out again. And in fact, we could use the deref mute tank, deref mute method that we've just defined on it to get a mutable reference to that data on the other side of the portal, like through the portal, and go and kind of do that. Now, that is essentially, with some asterisks around zero size types and a couple of other bits and pieces, that is an implementation of box. So this is what box is doing when it... when you call box new, it goes, sets up some, oh gosh. It goes and sets up some space for your data to live, and then it sends the data down there on the, and then provide space for you to, or like a mechanism for you to go and access the data from the box and kind of pull it out when you need it. Again, I prefer my analogy to the rest of the industry, but we'll just allow that to slide for the moment. Hope this has been a fun tour of some of the capabilities of the lower level language. And I really encourage you, as you can, to read some of this more advanced stuff available to you in some of the advanced documentation. It doesn't necessarily need to be taken on at, sorry, it doesn't necessarily mean that you need to learn everything at once, but there is a lot that is quite fun. So you'll definitely stretch yourself as you go forward. So I'm going to, I am going to wind up, and I hope you have had a fun tour. Cheers. Bye.